Have you ever wondered if there are more natural ways to lower your high blood pressure, guard against Alzheimer's, lose weight, feel better? Well, it turns out there is. Welcome to the Nutrition Facts Podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Michael Greger. Today we continue our series on NAD+, an enzyme that is found in all living things and supposedly boosted by a variety of supplements. Let's look at nicotinamide. Here's our first story. Ever since nicotinamide, NAM, was also shown to cure pellagra, both nicotinic acid NA and NAM have been collectively referred to as niacin, or vitamin B3, though they are distinct compounds. For example, NAM is not plagued by the same kind of hot flash reaction. Facial flushing attributed to niacinamide in some older studies were likely due to a less purified form contaminated with residual NA. The relative capacity of NA versus NAM to generate NAD is unclear. Neither has been shown to boost sirtuin activity, but both do extend the lifespan of C. elegans. I couldn't find any longevity trials for NA in rodents. However, NAM was put to the test and failed to prolong the lives of mice. What clinical effects might we expect in people? Previously, I explored the proven anti-aging effects for topical nicotinamide on the skin, and the remarkable ability of oral nicotinamide to help prevent skin cancer. I also noted it failed to prevent type 1 diabetes, despite promising mouse data, though it may help preserve residual function in people newly diagnosed with type 1 diabetes, but apparently not enough to affect blood sugar control. What about its use as an NAD booster? In those with mitochondrial myopathy, NA raised muscle NAD levels and improved mitochondrial muscle function, but in healthy individuals, muscle NAD levels didn't budge. However, the average age of individuals in the control group was 50. What about an older adult whose muscle NAD levels might potentially be lower? 4 NAD precursors were tested in older adults, averaging in their 70s: tryptophan, NA, NAM, and NR. All 4 failed to improve muscle strength or function, failed to affect mitochondrial function, and failed to even nudge NAD levels in their muscles. Why not give it a try anyway? Again, side effects. Like NA, high-dose NAM can cause gastrointestinal disturbances and signs of liver toxicity. However, NAM may result in more issues involving methylation. The first step in breaking down excess NAM is to transfer a methyl group to it, forming methylnicotinamide. Unfortunately, methylnicotinamide is neurotoxic and can cross the blood-brain barrier. This may explain why NAM can exacerbate Parkinson's-like symptoms in rats, and why Parkinson's patients have higher levels of the NAM methylating enzyme in their brains, the same with Alzheimer's brains for that matter. Excess NAM may also deplete the body's pool of methyl groups. If you read the epigenetics chapter in my book, How Not to Age, you may remember that DNA methylation is critical for the regulation of gene expression. Epigenetic changes caused by NAM-induced methyl depletion have been blamed as the reason why rats fed megadoses of NAM suffer from fatty livers and swollen kidneys. But that was at a human equivalent dose far exceeding what people might take. Is there any evidence that more modest NAM supplementation might affect methylation in humans? Yes, and even with a single dose as low as 100 milligrams. Methylation also plays a key role in breaking down fight-or-flight hormones like noradrenaline and neurotransmitters like serotonin and histamine. Within hours of a single 100 milligram dose of NAM, blood levels of all 3 become elevated, suggesting their metabolism was impaired by the shunting of methyl groups to deal with the excess NAM. Also noted was a significant rise in homocysteine, which is a byproduct of methylation reactions and a risk factor for cardiovascular disease and dementia. Another potential problem with NAM is that it's a sirtuin inhibitor. Wait, I thought the whole purpose of taking NAD precursors is to boost sirtuin activity. Sirtuin enzymes use up NAD+ and spit out NAM. This allows the body to recycle the NAM back into NAD for further sirtuin use. But it also means the body can use NAM as part of a negative feedback loop. Like a thermostat in the winter that shuts down the furnace when there's too much heat, The body shuts down NAD use by sirtuins when it detects too much NAM. NAM pills didn't exist when our bodies evolved, so in the wake of a sudden wave of NAM, the body must think its sirtuins are churning out too much and dials them back. Perhaps this explains why NAM fails to prolong the lifespans of mice. When the sirtuin-suppressing effects of NAM were first reported 20 years ago, the researchers cautioned that this could potentially lead to deleterious consequences of long-term nicotinamide therapy in humans. In our next story, we look at how the suppression of NAD plus synthesis by a purported NAD booster called NR in humans may explain the disparate rodent results. NR and NMN seem to be more promising NAD precursors than NA or NAM, since they don't cause flushing, nor do they directly inhibit sirtuins. In mice, NR and NMN both raised liver NAD levels, but of the two, only NR significantly raised NAD in the muscles. Also, NR is so far the only NAD booster shown to prolong the lifespan of mice. There have been at least 10 clinical trials of NR, most showing it can boost human blood levels of NAD by up to 168%. Note, though, that most doses used exceeded 300 milligrams, which is the daily dose approved as safe by the U.S. Food and Drug Administration and the European Food Safety Authority. At the approved dose, blood NAD is boosted more on the order of 50 to 60%, but no dose was found to affect NAD levels in human muscle compared to placebo. The greater preponderance of human bioavailability and safety data for NR compared to NMN has led some to proclaim NR as the preferred NAD precursor. And by some, I mean employees of a chemical company that produces NR for supplements. The question, after all these human NR trials, is, have any of them shown clinical benefit? Sadly, no. Let's go through the alphabet. After accounting for multiple testing, randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled trials of NR in middle-aged or older adults failed to find any significant benefit over placebo for artery stiffness or artery function, BAT activation, blood pressure, blood sugar control, body weight, cardiac energy or ejection fraction, fat burning, fatty liver, exercise capacity, fatigue, insulin sensitivity, metabolic flexibility, metabolic health, metabolic rate, mitochondrial function or biogenesis, muscle blood flow, upper or lower body muscle strength, pancreatic function or the release of metabolic hormones, the treatment of Parkinson's disease symptoms, or physical performance. NR hawking companies claim NR is anti-inflammatory, but in their own study, only 3 out of 10 markers of inflammation were affected compared to placebo, and a subsequent independent study using the same dose for twice as long found 0 of 12 markers affected. Remarkably, the opposite was found for many of these outcomes in rats and mice. In rodents, NR does raise NAD levels in muscles, improving insulin sensitivity, mitochondrial biogenesis, and on down much of the list. Why does NR work in rodents, but appear to almost entirely flop in people? Some have suggested inadequate dosing. The typical dose used in mouse studies is about twice that used in many human studies, but a double dose has been tried in people to no avail. Another possibility is sirtuin inhibition by NAM, the main degradation product of NR. In fact, based on mouse studies, NR may metabolize in the gut into NAM or NA before it even makes it into the bloodstream. Either way, unlike in mice, NR can't seem to elevate NAD in human muscle, so no wonder there's no alteration of human sirtuin activity. Maybe that explains the disparate results? In fact, the key NAD synthesizing enzyme in human muscle biopsies was actually suppressed by NR supplementation. That doesn't happen in mice, but it does in people. Presumably, this downregulation is an adaptive response to the unnaturally large flood of NR coming into the system. So what happens when you stop taking the supplement? How quickly does your enzyme activity bounce back? In mice, not only may their microbiome affect NR, but the NR may affect their microbiome too. Some of the benefits of NR can then be transferred between mice via fecal transplants. So, at least in mice, some of the benefits of NR may be due to modulating the mouse microbiome. The distinct differences between the gut flora of humans and rodents may offer another explanation why NR works in them but not us. Unlike NAM, supplementation with NR did not increase homocysteine levels, but one study of a combination of NR plus a resveratrol analog called terostilbene raised LDL cholesterol high enough to kill as many as 1 in 40 long-term users. However, this effect is presumed to be due to the terostilbene, as NR alone has not been shown to raise LDL, whereas terostilbene has. One study did find that NR seemed to cause a small reduction in hematocrit, hemoglobin, and platelet count in people within a week of starting it. This shift towards a more anemic state was suggested to account for impaired exercise performance seen in rats given NR. However, the 35% drop in performance did not reach statistical significance. NR did cause a significant increase in systemic oxidative stress, however, and another rodent study found a worsening of inflammation and deterioration of metabolic health. But if positive effects in rodents don't translate to people, perhaps we shouldn't expect the negative ones will either. Regulatory authorities from Australia, Canada, Europe, and the United States have all authorized NR as safe, at least up to 300 mg a day, or 230 in pregnant and lactating women. But the lack of demonstrable clinical benefit would seem to preclude NR supplementation. Visit NutritionFacts.org/audio to see all the podcast episodes with descriptions that include links to their associated videos. Sources cited and other details are available on each video's page. Information about my books, How Not to Die, How Not to Diet, How Not to Age, is at NutritionFacts.org/books. All proceeds from book sales go to charity. And sign up for our free newsletter at NutritionFacts.org/subscribe to stay updated on the latest bite-sized videos and articles. NutritionFacts.org is a science-based nonprofit, and everything on the website is free. There are no ads, no corporate sponsorships, no kickbacks, strictly non-commercial, not selling anything. Just put it up as a public service, as a labor of love, as a tribute to my grandmother, whose own life was saved with evidence-based nutrition. Thanks for listening.